Hey there, cats and kittens, and thanks for tuning in to another episode of The Monkey Boy Presents the DC Comics Superhero Collection by Eaglemoss. And today I'm happy to bring you the fourth issue in the Blackest Night, Brightest Day subseries, Saint Walker, the first Blue Lantern in the galaxy, one of my favorite characters, to be totally honest with you. And while I'm not a fan necessarily of the entire storyline that was Blackest Night, Brightest Day, I am a fan of a lot of the characters that came out of it, and I do dig the whole concept of the color spectrum in the galaxy, not just Green Lanterns, but a whole different color spectrum of lanterns. For those of you who know Saint Walker, chances are you know him from the unfortunately recently canceled Green Lantern, the animated series on Cartoon Network, where he appeared on a few episodes, even appearing in his alter ego of Bro-D before he was made into a full-fledged Blue Lantern. And for those of you who are not aware of this character, well, that's why we have the magazine, which of course we'll take a look at first, and it'll tell you everything you ever wanted to know about the first Blue Lantern in the galaxy, also known as Saint Walker. And you'll notice that this magazine brings back the Book of Oa, this time featuring a little bit more information about the Green Lantern Corps. And then we'll take a look at the figure itself, covering the good, the bad, and the ugly. One of my favorite characters, a really nice figure, very, very intricately detailed. Of course, you'll see that very shortly. Please sit back, relax, and enjoy issue number 4 of the Blackest Night, Brightest Day subseries collection from Eaglemoss, Saint Walker. First up, the character section. Which introduces us to an alien named Brody Walker from a planet called Estonia. And we learn that in addition to being a loving husband and father, he was also deeply devoted to the most ancient religion on the planet. When the planet learned that their son was dying, Brody took it upon himself to go on a pilgrimage with his family in an effort to reach out to their ancient god. Brody finally made it to the peak of Mount Helios after losing his family tragically along the way, only to find no one waiting for him at the summit. As the rain began to fall on Brody, he noticed the dust and dirt wash off the stone, and he saw his own reflection in the face of it. Filled with a renewed sense of hope and that all would be well, Walker began to preach to the people in the town, to whoever would stop and listen to him. It was around this same point in time that two former Guardians of the Universe with the Green Lantern Corps had splintered off and created a new corps in the universe, the Blue Lanterns. St. Walker's first assignment as Blue Lantern was to seek out the Green Lantern known as Hal Jordan and bring him back to the Blue Lantern's home planet of Odom. St. Walker and Hal Jordan fought against Atrocitus and the Red Lantern Corps in an effort to stop them from executing Sinestro, but along the way, Hal Jordan was seduced by the red power of rage and was temporarily made a Red Lantern, that is, until St. Walker and the Blue Light of Hope rescued him. Walker on how Jordan managed to bring together a representative from every color in the energy spectrum in order to fight against the oncoming Black Lanterns. Next, we look at a few more stories from the event known as Blackest Night. First up, Blackest Night, The Outsiders. And this story continues to follow the undead Black Lantern version of Terra, who had just come from terrorizing and even killing a few members of her former teammates in the Teen Titans. Now she seeks out the Outsiders and her brother, the hero known as Geoforce. She uses her brother's sympathy to get close to the team, only to turn on them, and he is forced to turn her to stone in order to save the others. It's another very scary entry in the Blackest Night series. Next, we look at Blackest Night, Justice League of America. As this story opens, we find the then-current lineup of the Justice League returning home to the Hall of Justice, only to find that storing the bodies of their fallen heroes and villains within the hall may not have been the best idea when the bodies begin to reanimate themselves and turn into Black Lanterns. Heroes fight heroes, heroes fight arch-villains who are thought long dead, and in the end, some of the Justice League don't make it out of this very crazy story alive. Finally, we look at Blackest Night, Teen Titans. And this tale is pretty unique because instead of following the heroics of the Teen Titans, it follows their arch-nemesis Deathstroke the Terminator as he is forced to fight with zombified undead versions, Black Lantern versions, of his dead wife, brother, and son. He also goes to the aid of his two still-living children, Jericho and Ravager, who are now both heroes with the Teen Titans, in an effort to not only protect them from these evil Black Lanterns, but also to find some sort of forgiveness. It's actually a very well-written tale that, again, is very creepy. And Walker's iconography page features a two-page fold-out poster that talks all about the Blue Lantern Corps. It features their home planet of Odom, tells that the color blue on the emotional spectrum stands for hope, features other members of the Blue Lantern Corps, and, my favorite part, it features the Blue Lantern Oath. St. Walker's Friends and Foes section features even more Black Lanterns this time, including Black Lantern versions of Jonah Hex, the heroic Animal Man, and the second Blue Beetle, Ted Kord. And finally, St. Walker brings us the second chapter in the Book of Oa, which talks more about the Green Lantern Corps. In addition to featuring a number of other Green Lanterns, it talks about how the Green Lantern Corps was created by the Guardians of the Universe after their previous attempt at establishing order in the galaxy through the cyborgs known as the Manhunters failed. The Guardians created what is known as the Central Power Battery on a planet known as Oa, which serves as the central power source for all of the Green Lanterns in the universe. The Guardians also very carefully and meticulously wrote down a set of guidelines that were basically the founding laws by which the Green Lantern Corps would be governed, how they would train their candidates, and how they would be selected. This came to be known as the Book of Oa. This section gives a little bit more detail about each individual Green Lantern's personal power battery and power ring. We also learn that the only color on the emotional spectrum that the Green Lantern's ring cannot affect is the color yellow, because it represents fear. And here we have the first Blue Lantern, Saint Walker, also known as Brody, and I think this is a great figure. It's one of my favorites in this collection, the Blackest Night, Brightest Day collection. He is really hard to get a good look at from this angle, unfortunately, just because of his pose and because of his size. He's very tall and he's very spindly. He's really thin. but there's great details all over this guy, as I'm sure you can tell. The paint is really fantastic. I love that shade of blue. It's just really neat. It's really clean. And the metallic flecking in it is superb. It's not too heavy in any spot. And it just, it looks almost like armor in a sense. But you can see just how glossy and shiny it is. It's really neat. His skin tone, his flesh tone is very nice. It's sort of this grayish color with a really nice texture to it, and I love that head tail, that tendril. It's just really nicely done. I like how it's sort of got that curve to it, and it comes to that little point on the end, all the way down to his feet, which again are really awesome. He looks as though he's flying, and he's using the blue energy to hover. It's just a great pose. You can see again how thin he is. He's just really, really thin, which is one of the downsides to him, I suppose. He's kind of fragile. But anyway, I really like this figure a lot. I'll show you some more of these details here and talk a little bit more about him in just a moment. Zane Walker hovers above the Blue Lantern logo, and the underside of the base features his name and serial number. And to give you a sense of size and scale, here he is next to one-time member of the Blue Lantern Corps, the Flash. Next to his friend and one-time teammate, Hal Jordan of the Green Lantern Corps. And a nice group shot of the other members of the various cores in the color spectrum. Saint Walker is another fantastic addition to this line. If you know Blackest Night, Brightest Day, I think you owe it to yourself to make him a part of your collection. He is really outstanding as far as the sculpt and the paint and the pose is concerned, and the good far outweighs the bad. As always, we'll start with the good, which definitely outweighs the bad on this guy. It's another very impressive addition to this collection. I really like the pose a lot. I think it's very iconic. It represents his character very well. You get a sense of his hopeful emotion is in the sculpt, too. The paint is clean. I really like how he's hovering. You can see the base has that glowing blue energy, which is, again, really nicely done. It's got a nice texture to it, a great paint job. It's a slightly different blue than the metallic blue of the costume. And the sculpt in the legs is really nice. He looks wiry, he looks thin, but at the same time, you can still see the musculature. And the blue paint is just really clean. It's really even. There's not too much metallic flecking. And his whole flying gimmick here reminds me of Jon Stewart from the regular collection, one of the other Green Lanterns. It's very reminiscent of that, and it's kind of neat having them side by side. The costume is really cool as well. I dig the design of the Blue Lantern costumes, and I like how every Lantern core is reminiscent of the other. You can kind of tell they're all sort of a Lantern core, but they're slightly different in design, and Blue Lantern here is no different. I like the black, how it's nice and flat against that glossy metallic blue. All the way around, great sculpt, great pose. I like how thin he is, yet muscular at the same time. Very, very thin athletic build on this character. The metallic blue, as I said, is nice and even all the way around, front and back. Again, great sculpt, cool pose. I like the hands, how they're both open. You don't have very many open-palmed characters in this collection, and I like the bracers around the wrists and forearms. There is some nice sculpt on the palms of the hands. You can see lines and ridges and things where his, you know, knuckles and his fingers bend, of course, and the right hand has the blue power ring on the middle finger, and while it's not extremely detailed, at least it's there, and it is more than just a glob of paint on the finger, it actually wraps all the way around the finger and is also detailed on the inside of that open palm, which I think is a great detail. He's the only Lantern character in the collection so far, at least, that has that sort of detail. The head sculpt, I'm going to start with the tail on this character. The tail, the head tentacle, I don't know what you would call it, is really, really fantastic. I like how big and long and interesting it is. I like how there are the lines that are not just painted on, but also sculpted into that sort of head-tail thing. I like how it looks as though it's moving around and is sort of, it was organic, because of course it is, it's part of him. Again, the flesh tone is really nice, and the facial sculpt on this head sculpt is perfect. It looks just as Saint Walker should. The face is very hopeful looking, I think. The lips have a slight pinkish tint to them. The eyes are just those little black dots. He has the white teeth, and again, the lines on the face are not just painted on, they're also sculpted into the head sculpt. And I really think he is a nice figure overall. on to the bad, which is where I get nitpicky with this character. First off, the symbol on the chest, while it is accurate, perfect, it is the Blue Lantern logo. It is a decal, which is always unfortunate. However, I can see why they decided to go with a sticker, because it is a very intricate logo, and he is a rather small figure. Also, on mine, the right hand has some webbing between those fingers. It's just paint bleed, and you really don't notice it unless you're looking hard, but it does sort of bother me, and it's something you may want to check if you have the ability to. Finally, the ugly, and I think it goes without saying, pretty much everything on this guy is very fragile. He is one of the most fragile figures in the collection just because he is so thin. His base is very thin. The hands, the arms, the head-tail thing, all of it is extremely fragile. If he tips over or falls over from too great a height, he is going to break. And you may also want to check him in the packaging to make sure he isn't already broken if you have the ability to. Overall, I'm very happy with Saint Walker. I think he is one of the most unique-looking figures, one of the coolest-looking characters. I like the blue, I like the costume, I love the pose. And I dig the whole Blackest Night, Brightest Day storyline for the most part. Blackest Night more so than Brightest Day. I really like the alien characters too, which is something, as I've said, this line delivers on. Is he for everyone? Definitely not. He, again, is only for those who are familiar with this storyline or know him from the cartoon show and happen to be a fan of this guy. Otherwise, I could see why you would skip over him, and you probably would have no idea who this guy is. But if you know him, you like him, and you want to have yet another really awesome addition to the color spectrum, which continues to grow, I highly recommend it, adding Saint Walker, the one and only Blue Lantern in this collection, I might add, to your personal collection. And I hope you have enjoyed my review of the fourth issue in the Blackest Night, Brightest Day subseries collection here, Saint Walker. Please stay tuned for a quick teaser trailer of the next figure in the line. We go back to the regular Eaglemoss DC superhero collection with this next one. Another former villain turned hero, and one of the most quirky, crazy, and he is actually a self-aware comic book hero. So stay tuned for that really interesting figure. As always, I am your host, the Monkey Boy, aka J to his friends. Thanks for watching.